premier ski area, home of America's premier ski event, the Aspen Winter National Subaru World Cup Competition. So grab your gear and share the excitement as we go skiing American style. Hill on snow on purpose probably did it in ancient Persia, 4,000 years BC before Christ. By the Middle Ages, the sport had spread across Europe, 900 years BC before Blue Cross. To tell the story of skiing American style, there's no better time or place to start than 1879 in Aspen, Colorado. The town struck it rich on silver, boomed like crazy for 14 well-heeled years, then busted flatter than a Denver omelet when the market collapsed in 1893. All that remained was a handful of mostly broke people and snow. Lots and lots of snow. More than 300 inches of it each winter, all powdery and perfect for skiing. But it wasn't until 1935 that the world began shoveling a path back to Aspen's door. At the eager urging of Swiss ski expert André Roche, who surveyed the slopes and deemed them better than his native Alps. Just one word from Roche, and a whole new Aspen boom was on. On, that is, until World War II shut it off again, while the young men of the Army's 10th Mountain Division borrowed the snow to learn the ups and downs of alpine combat. Back came the civilians in 1945, and up went the resorts and new ski trails and the longest lift on Earth. Everything Aspen needed to put American skiing on the world map, up to and including the ultimate touch of class, the World Racing Championships of 1950. Top flight competition that even made the movie-tone newsreel sit up and take notice.
Spectacular skiing that delights the most discerning. Whizzing wizardry that spells speeds of better than a mile a minute. Pell-mell plummeting that sometimes proves too swift to pace. Zooming to the title, averaging 53 miles an hour, Italy's Zeno Colo. Colo, it was colossal.
The Aspen of the 1950s has come a long way in its rise as America's best all-round ski area. Today, it's a sophisticated big city, tucked nicely inside a small, friendly town. An easygoing place, internationally known as a center for art, music, literature, and special education. Not to mention nightlife, the Aspen Club, and most of all, skiing. Four major mountains worth, 2,300 acres of splendor, crisscrossed by 207 ski trails, totaling 100 miles long. Aspen's as relaxed and remote as any ski resort can get, even though Denver's only 40 minutes away by air. Since 1980, Aspen's good points have only gotten better, with the annual running of the Aspen Winter National Subaru World Cup Races, an official American leg of the International Grand Prix Circuit for downhill and slalom competition. Here's where the U.S. ski team comes home to tangle with the best the world has to offer. The dazzling capper to a full Winter National week of festivities and a full-out fight for the title of top skier on Earth. Aspen World Cup action has always had great moments, but none ever more memorable than the 1981 giant slalom showdown between Sweden's all-time Olympic champion Ingemar Stenmark and America's hard-charging Phil Mayer. At the time, both men were just percentage points apart in the stretch run for the World Cup. For Mayer, as an American, it was the race and chance of a lifetime.
Pushing out of the start comes Phil Mayer in his second and final run of this giant slalom in Aspen, Colorado. It's the eighth giant slalom of the season out of 11 overall. And at the top, Ingemar Stenmark readies himself for this second one for him in this giant slalom. In the middle section, Phil Mayer, very aggressive, very smooth now. And Mayer trying to make up that time. He stood second behind Stenmark after the first run. Out at top is Ingemar Stenmark, the number one ski racer in the world. He is known to do extremely well in his second runs of events. At the bottom, Phil Mayer coming into the final few turns on the course as the crowd begins to intensify. Here comes Mayer towards the finish. He's going to have an excellent time as he skates his way around the last gate and across the finish line in 1 minute. 37.33. An incredibly fast pace Mayer has set for Ingemar Stenmark. The crowd has gone crazy. Stenmark trying to pick up the pace. He needs better than 1 minute. 37.52. Across the finish line in time. 1:37.66. It's not going to be...
Mayer's victory over Stenmark was the historic turn for the entire 1981 skiing season by the Aspen Foundation. For the Stars, the 83 Challenge race was a perfect way to support a good cause while having... Practice very definitely made perfect at the 1983 Aspen Winter National, as skiing's biggest big names and brightest newcomers went nose to nose again in Subaru World Cup competition.
Far, we've been traveling far, not without a star.
One event all fans came to see in 83, the downhill, America's downhill.
America's downhill course is one of the best tests for the world's best downhill racers. At the edge of town on Aspen Mountain, the 2-mile-long course drops 2,500 vertical feet. The racers average over 65 miles an hour. I carried the video camera down the course to give you a racer's eye view. The top is...
He owed his point total to his best event, the giant slalom. This time around, he was determined to prove he could be a downhill winner, too.
I think our skis are running very well on the top flats, and then the bottom is very technical, and if I ski well, I think I can do well here.
But to make his downhill dream come true, Phil Mayer had to beat this man, Todd Brooker of Canada. And Brooker wasn't about to give an inch. He had also come to win. Tim Ryan and Billy Kidd called the action.
He will push himself right to the absolute limit. Brooker last year, if you remember, got his ski up beside him. He's a good glider. He'll carry a lot of speed into this section right here, Aztec, but this is the place to watch him.
Hard to believe he's had six knee operations. This guy's already had a win at Kitzbühel on a technical course. Let's see how he goes through here.
He's extremely strong. Watch how he tried to screw that out. His skis will bounce around. He'll try to use his knees like shock absorbers. There's where he had trouble last year, Tim. He got in trouble again here this year. This is where Podborski just barely made it through right there. This is the toughest section.
It looked like a replay of last year, although he didn't keep that ski up so high and pulled out of it again. He's amazing how strong he is. Look at the ruts. You can really see the ruts in the course, how rough it is.
Watch his outside ski bounce around. He tries to keep his hands in front to decrease that wind resistance. He has got a great run going here, Tim. The last bump around Norway Island into the air. He's got a great run, Tim.
There's the time to beat Meyer in the lead, 1:48.24. The last turn for Brooker, driving for the finish line. He can catch him. Todd Brooker, the young Canadian, 1:47.87. And he is the new leader here in the World Cup America's downhill, Todd Brooker.
Phil Mayer was clearly down in the numbers. Down, but not out. Not quite. Not yet. He could still beat Brooker, but he knew he could only do it if he ran the downhill better than he had ever run it before.
And the young American from White Pass, Washington, who currently leads the overall World Cup standings.
Look at the wind blowing up there. This is really becoming a factor, this weather here. Phil Mayer has not been training a lot in downhill other than the races that he's been in. But he wants to win this very badly. I think you'll see him pushing very hard down here. Look at his tuck. He's got an excellent aerodynamic position.
Phil had a fifth at St. Anton, Austria. Pretty good finish for a guy who doesn't specialize in it, but he wants to win one. We keep emphasizing that because Phil has all week long.
Well, he would like to win a downhill, and this is a downhill that he can do well on. Because this snow is soft, because the course is rough, Phil Mayer is really a guy that pushes hard. But this is the key place right in here, this next right-hand turn onto Aztec. Now watch Phil Mayer go. This is Quincy's best right here. Coming down Aztec. Skis bouncing around. Hands are wild. He is outside the track. He is trying to go so straight. He is really pushing. He wants to win this, Tim.
This is Vintage Mayer going for it all. And you can hear the crowd along the track cheering for Phil Mayer, the American favorite here. A little bumpy through there, but he makes a good turn.
He was excellent through there, Tim. He came around in front of the Berlin Wall. He was really good. Now here's the right turn. Down on this mile, and he's in trouble. He put his hand down at 65 miles an hour.
Unbelievable recovery by Mayer. He nearly went down as he was back on his skis, but he pulled out of it. Now that'll cost him time-wise. Can he catch Brooker? It's unlikely, but you know he'll be driving for the finish. Brooker's time to beat 147.87. Mayer, last ski to the finish, and he cannot catch Todd Brooker. But Phil Mayer moves into eighth place, 149.08.
Mayer's time was good, but not good enough.
American team.